So this is lecture four. We talked last time about algorithmic filters. So using the document vector space to try to build news filtering systems that collected all of the stories, or all of the stories that are in the same event together, put them into topics, and then chose a certain subset of that to show to the user. That's sort of the beginning of filtering. Today we're going to try to talk about the rest of it, because real filtering systems are much more complicated than that, because there's all of this social interaction. But before we do that, we're going to talk about the assignment that you all just helped out with, which is great. I think the results are actually really, really interesting. So if you recall, the point of this was to, we went through this whole technique for extracting keywords from a document, this classic technique called TF-IDF, which is still in very wide use in forms that are only very slightly more complicated than what you did for the assignment. And the question is, are these keywords representative? What do they tell us about the documents as compared to just reading the documents? So I'm only going to take you through the results for 1 year, because we'd be here a very long time. But I am going to publish the results on the blog of the, I think, 4 years, 80, 90, 2000, 2010, where we have comparisons available. And so this is what it looks like when you extract that list of keywords. These are the top words for the 2000 State of the Union speech by Bill Clinton. And so you can sort of, I don't know, I think you can sort of get an idea of what he's talking about. You know, tonight, that's not that interesting, really. But gun, college, globalization, internet, affordable child, 21st Americans, Medicare, help, high-tech, aging, technology. You can see, well, let's see what you all thought this is about. Notice that I've also included the time, because that's a critical part of this test, right? It's not just what can you find out doing this, but how long did it take? Because if you're a reporter and you've got far more material than you can read, which is very often the case, right? So, you know, I've worked with reporters at the AP, and routinely you'll get 5 or 10,000 pages backed from a Freedom of Information request. And you can't read 10,000 pages on deadline. So it's not just what you get, but how long. So I'll let you read this. They're saying it's basically about gun ownership. There's some high tech and globalization, and then caring for old people and children in the 21st century is sort of what this one says. This one's kind of interesting. Something jumps out at me in the first two sentences here. Anyone seen this? Yeah, this speech was not given by Bush. So of course this is a simple error on the part of the student who wrote this up. But I kept this one in because I think it demonstrates something really interesting, which is that, you know, if you don't actually look at the documents in some form, you can make your assumptions can be way off. I'm sure if I was analyzing Chinese political speeches, or I guess translations of Chinese political speeches, I would get all kinds of stuff wrong in terms of my sort of basic factual knowledge and history. What I'm trying to say is that keyword analysis is no substitute for actually being familiar with the context and the background assumptions of the material. And it's easy to make sort of big, obvious mistakes if you don't actually get in there and look. So in this case, you know, looking at the top of the speech where it says who gave it would have solved this. And this is very typical of this type of computer analysis. The main problem with any text analysis work is that it's very often acontextual. It doesn't mean a lot unless you already know something. Other than that, roughly the same. High tech, internet, globalization, this tax credit thing, aging, digital divide. Anyway. Then we get to the first summary, human written summary. First thing that jumps out is took way longer. This took 2 hours to produce as opposed to 10 minutes, 15 minutes. This is a nice piece of journalistic writing. It uses quotes that are illustrative, you know, very standard journalistic technique. That first quote, "We are fortunate to live. Never before has our nation enjoyed at once so much prosperity and social progress with so little internal crisis and so few external threats." Very different world he's describing just 13 years ago. And of course, 9 months before September 11th. And you can see a few things come out. You know, there's talking about jobs and, but gun control is way down there, right? Look at this. This person summarized it and felt that gun control was really a minor thing, whereas the TF-IDF put that way up top. Why do you suppose TF-IDF put guns right at the top of this speech if they were a minor part of it?
May not be mentioned in that many other speeches.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, this was probably one of the only State of the Union addresses that had the word gun in it. And so in that sense, pulling gun to the top makes sense. The algorithm did what it was supposed to do. But that doesn't mean that a human summarizing this speech is going to want to talk about guns. So you can see here, guns, the human mentioned it just as a footnote here. Or from the extent, I shouldn't really say humans versus machines because it's all humans here. But let's say the computer assisted reading versus the manual reading or traditional reading. And there's this sense of optimism that's mentioned, which I'm not sure if you can get optimism from looking at this. I don't think that jumps out at me. I wouldn't look at that list and think, oh, this president is very optimistic. So the mood of the speech is lost, even though all of the individual words might still be there. Okay. But otherwise, it's kind of there, right? We're talking about healthcare. We're talking about internet stuff. But it's a little bit different. Here's another manual reading. Similar thing, right? Very buoyant time. A bunch of other stuff here. Mentioning, where is it? Hopes the nation can use its economic and military influence to help spread democracy, bring peace. That didn't really come out in here at all. Why do you think, you know, democracy, peace, military, why wouldn't they have appeared in this list?
They would
probably appear in most speeches. Right. Most presidents say democracy. Probably democracy is mentioned in every speech. Right? How can you give a speech on the State of the Union without mentioning democracy? You know, socialism with Chinese characteristics is not going to be extracted by TF-IDF. It's going to be suppressed because it's not an interesting word, right?
Democracy did appear in some of the sort of 1920s. So does that mean it was set a huge amount then in those speeches?
I mean, I suppose more than average. I mean, remember also it's all of this stuff is normalized, right? So it could be, and this is one of the weaknesses of this technique, that there just weren't that many words which had particularly high scores. You could see whether that's the case by looking at the distribution of the scores and see if they have a sharp peak at the first few words or if they have a long tail. And that will tell you whether a few words are really distinctive or whether it's kind of a, yeah, exactly, kind of a mush. So there's some diagnostics you could do to figure that out. Anyway, we're not going to go through all of them because we would spend a long time reading slides full of text, but I am going to post them and I urge you to take a look. I'm going to try to write up my own little analysis and comparison. I haven't seen this before. Now, I think it's unlikely that you would use TF-IDF to summarize a single speech. I think it's much more likely that you would just, you know, read the speech. But you would be using it to do clustering, right? If you so, as Overview does with the groups that it builds it based on closeness of the feature vectors, and the feature vectors are TF-IDF weights. And most other types of sort of keyword extraction, document grouping, you know, topic extraction are going to use TF-IDF or something very like it. So I think it gives an insight into what sort of things are not going to be captured. Your topic extraction is probably not going to be good at figuring out mood, for example, unless it's really explicit, right? But there's a lot of ways to communicate optimism in a text other than having words like, you know, hope and happy and all of that stuff, right? It's a feature of the language which is a little more subtle and not so easily encoded in words. And you also know that it's going to highlight things which maybe shouldn't necessarily be highlighted simply because they're rare, right? So you can have words can go right to the top of the list simply because they're unusual. So if you had someone who just uses slightly different language or mentions a rare topic in passing, it can actually give too much weight to the rare words. But I suppose the other thing that I want to say to you is look at the time here, 15 minutes, 10 minutes, 120 minutes, 90 minutes. So we're looking at a factor of 5 to 10 in terms of time spent. So if we're, trying to go through a large volume of material very quickly, we might be able to narrow down the material we should be looking at very quickly using techniques based on this, and then do a more extended reading, or as literature scholars would say, a close reading of the particular documents or the particular aspects of the particular documents that concern us. Okay? Any other thoughts on the assignment? I know people had a lot of sort of little technical issues, and we can chat about those later. Questions? Comments? All right. So on to the main part. Social filtering. We built up this model of how information flows in journalism last week, and I'm gonna build a slightly different model this week. So this was this idea, right? Reporter writes a story, and then it gets published, and then something happens, which is actually silly. Really, the model is more, it's this more circular thing, right? The idea is that it's sort of a journalism is sort of a feedback mechanism. The journalist is producing some stories or some material that help people make choices that in turn shape the world. If you don't change your behavior, or at least your thought, as the result of journalism, then the journalism has no effect and there's not really any point doing it. Although, you know, I suppose it's still entertaining. And we very quickly went to this model, which is actually there's lots of things, not everything's covered. Then there's lots of stories, the user doesn't see all of them, and then they act on some subset. So this stuff here, you know, these red X's, that's the filtering. But there's a crucial missing part of this diagram, which this is, you can consider this a very traditional model of or thinking about how mass media works. But with social media, there's a missing part that's actually really important here. So what is it?
And with social media, you say?
Yeah.
Other users?
Yeah, other users. And what's that?
Filtering?
Yeah, filtering for each other. Or let me ask you this. Does the White House need journalists to communicate a message to the American public at this point?
No.
Yeah, I mean, I think generally no. The answer is probably a little bit more complicated because having it repeated in the New York Times confers a certain legitimacy and brings a certain amount of attention. But, you know, it's not like the Obama needs news channels to be heard by millions of people. You know, the State of the Union address now, there's this, it's live streamed with, you know, a multimedia presentation with charts on the side and conversation on whitehouse.gov, right? It's better than any news site, really. So we're going to start again. First of all, as you said, more than one user. And then this other thing, which is that sources can go direct, which is what that middle arrow is. That's a term which encodes this idea that the people who used to need to talk to a journalist to communicate widely actually don't need to anymore in many cases. Sources going direct, the middle arrow, and then you've got people in that loop passing information around too, which is why they're in the upper thing there. And then of course you've got, you know, blogging and social media of all types. So that's a little more accurate. And then there's this filtering feature as well, which is the material that the user on the far right receives is some combination of, you know, some of it comes from journalists. Actually, in this case, none of it comes from journalists. It's all been filtered out. But in principle, some of it does. And some of it comes from other users, and some of it comes directly from sources. And in this case, in the simplest possible case, which is probably the Twitter model, what information you get is entirely a function of who you decide to follow. So that is it's the first example we're going to look at. It's a purely social filter. I mean, there's software involved, but you couldn't really say it's an algorithm. Is letting someone follow somebody an algorithm? I don't know if I would call it that. It's social media. That's how it works. In Your Readings was a paper which analyzed the characteristics of the social network on Twitter. It's a cool paper. It just has some basic statistics and information. It has no nice fancy diagrams, hairball diagrams we call them. Big social networks like everybody likes to look at. But it does some basic sort of statistical analyses. And here we go. This is a 2010, I think. Anyway, so 40 million users, which is small now. I think they're up to 250 or 300 million. Anyway, 100 million tweets, which is actually a quarter of the tweets in a day now. So relatively small, but maybe enough information to look at some of the basic characteristics. So what could we ask about this network? How can we describe it? What might we want to know about it? Just basic stuff. So I might ask a question about, for example, does everybody kind of talk to each other, or are there a few people who are really celebrities that everyone follows, and they mostly follow them or other people? I could ask about the concentration of information flow. Because the mass media model is you have a very small number of sources who everybody gets their information from. But the pure peer-to-peer model is that you don't really have privileged nodes in the network. Everyone kind of gets their information from all over. So you can ask about that, and the simplest way to look at that is just look at the statistics of how many followers people have versus how many people they follow. So they did this. And just for terminology's sake, they called it followings and followers. Followings is kind of a strange word, but they had to call it something. So followings is, if I'm following 500 people, my followings is 500, and then, you know, 300 people is following me. Anyone want to take a stab at interpreting this graph? First of all, does do you know what CCDF is? Anyone? It's the
distribution.
What's that?
We're reading it from Google, but it's cumulative distribution function.
Yeah, it's actually the complement of the cumulative distribution function. So it's the way to read this is this. So you start here. Let's take the blue line, because that's followers. It's the easier one. And 100% of the people, or a fraction of 1, or 10 to the 0, have at least one following, right? And then when you get here to 10 to the 1, so that's 10. When you get to 10 followers, then you know some number less than 100% of users have 10 followers. And so you can read this, right? So 10 to the minus 2, so that's 1% of all users have a little more than 10 to 2, 120 followers. That's how you read this. It just shows so the drop-off. And it's exponential on both scales. I guess you call that logarithmic on both scales, sorry. Anyone know the significance of having a doubly logarithmic graph? What sort of patterns you would use that to see? So what does a straight line mean on a log-log graph? Anyone run into this? Yeah, exponential fall off, right? So if I've got a straight line that has slope, minus 2, then what I'm really looking at is something that falls off with an exponent of minus 2. So I would say, number of followers is, the fraction of people with that many followers is the number of followers, or e to the minus 2 times number of followers. So that constant just determines how fast that fall off is. But it says that it's an exponential fall off if I get a straight line. So fewer and fewer people have that many followers. And this is, nearly straight, especially for this blue one here. All of which is just a fancy way of saying that when you get to very high follower counts, it falls off very rapidly. And you can see that, right? So if I ask, how many people have 100 followers, well, that's like, 1%-ish of all people. If I say how many people have 100,000 followers, that's 1 in 100,000 people. And you can see it falls off even faster, right? Very few people have 1 million, and then nobody has 10 million at that time. What that means is this is kind of a celebrity structure. If everybody kind of talks to everybody, you would expect this curve to be pretty shallow. You would say, well, most people, I follow 100 people and 100 people follow me. But that's not really what you see. What you see is a very small number of people sort of to the right of this graph here who have a huge number of followers. And actually what it says is that every time I want to find someone with 10 times more followers, it gets about 10 times as rare. So that's the blue line. The red line is how many people it follow. And up near sort of the top of the graph where you have smallish numbers, people are generally following more than they are followed. So if you have up to about, that looks to be about, 1,500 or something, between 1,000 and 10,000. Or maybe 3,000, I don't know. Up to a few thousand followers, you're generally going to follow more people than you are followed. After that, you're sort of hit the celebrity side of the curve where more people are going to follow you than you follow. That's what this crossover is, right? So you can sort of say, well, over here is sort of the celebrities, and then over here is sort of the peons, right? So that's kind of an interesting thing to ask, right? Do I have more followers than people who follow me? It's like, it's so high school, right? Like, all of this stuff has really funny effects, right? I mean, I think less it used to be, but anyone here, you know, used to compare how many friends they have on Facebook to how many friends their friends have? It's like, ah, Jenny's got 800 friends and I only have 200. She's so popular.
Well, the new thing's clout scores, isn't it?
So. Oh God, clout scores. The next class is social network analysis, and we're gonna talk about influence scores and trying to interpret them. The next thing that we're going to look at is the average distance between any two nodes. So I take two random nodes, and I ask how many hops do I have to make to get between them. And I can go through any two people, right? So, you know, so it might be very short. If some celebrity is following me, and that lots of people are following that celebrity, then my distance to everybody who follows that celebrity is only two. So this isn't, you know, literally every message I send goes two hops to go to everybody, because obviously that's not how it works. That's potentially, in sort of the maximal retweet case, how long would it take? So what does this graph say? First of all, what do you see? Just describe to me the most basic feature of this graph. Yeah, big peak at 4. Okay, so if I pick two random people, most of the time it takes 4 jumps to get between from one to the other. What does that mean? Well, you know, as compared to if it was 10 or if it was 1, is that a lot? Think about it in terms of witness some event, right? The IFC explodes one night, and I'm the only one who witnesses it, let's say. And it's a little unlikely, but let's say. How fast is that news going to spread to a random other person on the network? The answer is right in that graph, right? So, oh my God, this building just blew up. Gonna get retweeted, you think? Yeah, lots of retweets. So how long is that gonna take to reach every other person in the network?
I mean, there's no time on that graph.
Yeah, I was gonna say.
Yeah, okay, so time's a funny one. So let's say how many steps to reach every other person in the network. Yeah, and so, I mean, you can see this is the cumulative graph. After 4 steps, it'll reach about 75%. After 5 steps, you're up at like, you know, almost 90 or almost 99, right? But anyway, so basically you're all over the network in 5 steps. So that tells you something about how fast information can theoretically spread. And then you start to ask questions like, well, you know, what is the time delay between seeing something and retweeting it? How many people are actually going to retweet? But this tells you that the network is actually very well connected. Information can move very, very fast through Twitter because even though you have 300 million users, you know, you as a journalist are only 4 or maybe 5 steps away from any other person on the network. So under ideal conditions, it will enter your timeline in 5 steps, you know, under a minute. Now, of course, the point of building filters from the point of view of a journalist is to make it even less, right? So you don't have to worry about whether it's ideal conditions or not. But even just, you know, I'm a random user, I'm just scrolling through my timeline, you're going to see stuff really fast. And you see this. I think we looked at this graph earlier. Who knows what this graph is? Yeah, that's the spread of information from Bin Laden. So Keith Urban is this guy who, I think he's still at the Defense Department. And he had this tweet, you know, I've just been told that Bin Laden was killed, went out to all these people, was retweeted. Brian Stelter was a New York Times reporter who's heavy into social media. And you can see this spread pattern. You know, this was the original source in this case. And it went through one intermediate step through Brian Stelter. So all of these people retweeted Keith Urban. And then all of these people were being followed by Brian Stelter. And then he retweeted it. So look at that one step, right? He wasn't following Keith Urban, but he was only one step away. And then you can see all of these other little retweet clusters. And it very quickly saturated the entire network. I don't know if you were following Twitter that night, but I was on Twitter, and it was just, it exploded. It was the most extraordinary thing. I had just gotten off a plane. I rushed into the newsroom. We were like, oh shit, we gotta, you know, fire up the Osama bin Laden timeline. It was a long night. Anyway, kind of fun though. Phenomenal method of distributing information. There's never been anything like it. So we talk about, we describe Twitter, you know, and by extension, you know, Weibo, which has, you know, retweet equivalents, right? We talk, and I'm not aware of a topology study on Sina or Tencent, but I'd be surprised if it was much different. It's not really a social network in the sense that Facebook is a social network. It's a little bit different because it has these hubs, right? These celebrities, and the connections are very dense. Information can flow really fast, and so it's used a little differently. Now, my question to you is, why doesn't Facebook have this property of sort of hyper rapid information spread? What's the difference? Yeah, that's it. So Twitter has asymmetric following, right? So if I follow you, I don't need your permission. In most cases, there are some closed Twitter accounts, but most aren't, right? So that means, so in Facebook, if you have a million friends, then every one of those million people had to friend you, and you know there had to be a two-sided transaction on it. But on Twitter, a million people can follow you without you ever knowing. And Facebook understands that, which is why they did the whole subscribe feature. They wanted that for a number of reasons. One was to get more people publishing publicly, because they saw that the public nature of Twitter meant that there were all of these amazing things you could build on top of it, and Facebook was still more private. So they tried to emulate that. But this one design choice in terms of whether you need an action on two sides to set up an information flow. And also it only flows one way, right? So if you have friends on Facebook, then potentially they see each other in the news feed. Whereas on Twitter, just because I followed you doesn't mean you follow me. This asymmetry completely changes the structure of the network and makes it an extraordinary information dissemination medium. This, I have a whole talk that I give on social software, which we're not going to do in this course. The only thing I really want to say here is that software design, small changes in software design, when that software is designed to be used by groups of people, can have enormous consequences for the types of interactions that occur. The way that I think of software design is architecture. Physical architecture, right? If I have a hallway, well, that's a thing that people walk down. If I put a fence up, that changes where people go. If I have a door locked or unlocked, that changes the pattern of movement. If I have, you know, a big round concrete bowl in the ground, I'm going to get skateboarders, right? It's all of these, you know, architecture in most cases doesn't prevent you from doing certain things. Except, you know, walls and locked doors. But in most cases, there's a way around it, right? You don't, you know, you could climb out of the buildings through the windows, but it sort of encourages certain types and modes of behavior. Or think about setting up tables, chairs in a conference room, or this classroom, right? any human who walks into this room, take out all of us, turn off the computers, any human who walks into this room is going to see a bunch of chairs facing a desk. They're going to know what happens in the room. Now, of course, I could stand over there, and you could all be talking to each other and ignoring me, so it's not like you have to do it, but it tends to produce certain types of interaction. And so when you're building software, you have to be aware that the choices you make will encourage but not dictate certain types of social behavior. And of course, you can generate entirely new types of behavior. That's what the like button is. Like user ratings, shares. You know, Facebook gets an enormous amount of data from the like button, and Reddit has the, you know, up and down voting. I'm going to pick on Reddit because we're going to study it later, but up and down voting buttons. You have given the user a way to do something that generates data that you can use for filtering. So when we talk about social filtering systems and social filtering algorithms, bear in mind that you can, you don't have to restrict yourself to the data that you have. You can make up new types of data if you can convince users to do it. But the key point there is if you can convince them to do it. So, you know, like generates all this data for Facebook. It's useful for filtering. For example, how might Facebook use like data for filtering? What would Facebook want to use that data for?
To help determine what you see in your newsfeed.
Yeah. So how would the likes on an item determine whether or not you see it?
Well, the history of likes, whether your friend has liked a lot of your content or vice versa.
Mm-hmm.
I guess increase the probability of going up.
Yeah. Generally speaking, the more likes something has, the more likely it is to be in your newsfeed. Right? But I don't think that people are thinking, oh, I really want this to rise to the top of the filtering algorithm when they click the like button. Why are they clicking the like button? Why do you click the like button? Because you like it. Okay, but why do you feel compelled to click the button? You're supporting your friends. So you want someone else to know that you like it. So if you didn't want anyone to know, would you click it? What I'm getting at is this is a social signal, right? The insight of the like button is that it's a social transaction. Social science researchers have a name for this. They call it aphatic communication, phatic. So I'm up here and I'm telling you equations and I'm giving you theory and we're talking algorithms. That's what we traditionally think of as communication, this sort of very rational analytical mind. Analytical sort of idea of what it is. But, you know, real communication and real people, right? So you're all sitting at a table and someone tells a joke and everyone laughs. Well, that's communication, but it's not ideas. Or, you know, body language, you know. Someone tells a joke and it's a terrible joke and everybody does this. Right? So it's all these things. And you can see it in all social animals, right? Now, you know, very low level, it's like ants and pheromones and things. But, you know, in the apes, it's grooming, picking lice off people. And all social animals have these systems of social communication. And they use them to basically say, it's like that movie. It's like, you suck, you suck, you suck, you're cool, you suck. Glad you came tonight, aren't you? Yeah. So it's this need to send these social signals in the online setting, which is why we have a lot of these things like buttons, and it's like the smallest possible unit of communication. Right? It's the one bit, because you could also leave a comment. You could be like, oh, that's awesome, but like is the smallest possible social communication you can have. And if it wasn't a social communication that humans intrinsically wanted to do, nobody would do it, because otherwise it's just work, and nobody wants that. Moving on to okay, so that was the sort of fluffier qualitative part of the evening. We're gonna just sort of plow through a bunch of algorithmic stuff for the next little bit, and then we're gonna end going back to some stuff that's easier because it'll be 9:30 and I'll be exhausted and you'll be exhausted. Finding sources on social media. You're journalists, you know that social media is a really important source of information. Ignore this for a second. I probably changed the slide too soon, but how do you actually find information? Like, how do you, you know, I assume that most of you are on Twitter, at least those of you who work as journalists professionally. How do you actually use Twitter? What's your user interface to that data stream?
TweetDeck.
Yep, TweetDeck. So most journalists I know, I'm sure this is going to say something embarrassing. Here you go. You can see who some of my friends are. Have, you know, TweetDeck open all day, and they're just watching it scroll by. What's the weakness of TweetDeck? Or really any standard Twitter client. What are you going to miss? What's that?
You have to click on it and read it.
You gotta read it, yeah. What else? How many people do you follow on Twitter? No one? Want to tell me how many people they follow on Twitter? Are you embarrassed that you're not celebrities? Is it 1,000? It's 1,000 for you? Is it 500? Who follows at least 500 people? Got one nod. Is it 200? Yeah, so, you know, somewhere under 1,000 for most people, right? There's millions of people on the network. So you might just not be following the right people. Now, it's quite likely that the information will get to you quickly, but not necessarily. So there's a couple ways we can deal with this. We have Twitter search. So this one's always fun. Oh, yeah, see, that makes it really fun. One moment, please. Yep, there you go. There's an explosion that happened 23 minutes ago. Another one. One in Iran, one in Switzerland. So you can do that. So search is good if you know what you're looking for. And you know, if you're working on a particular beat, you might have saved searches that are on particular things. What's the difference between search and a filter? Filtering in the sense that we're using it in this course. What's the difference?
Well, search is a positive thing. You're telling it what you're looking for.
Mm-hmm.
Filtering is a negative thing. It's taking away information.
It's taking away. Well, they both take away most of everything. You know, I'm now looking at 10 tweets out of millions. But you're on to something there. You're close. Anyone else want to try that one? Right. So search, you give it a particular thing that you want, and filtering as it comes to you. Now, they're interrelated, right? So I can set up a filter within a search. That, you know, they're very closely, right? So I can go to Google News and I can say, you know, show me stories about Belgium. And then within all of the stories on Belgium, it has to pick which ones to put at the top of the page. So they're not, and they use a lot of the same technology, but the basic difference from a user interface point of view and a workflow point of view is search is you're telling it what you want, which means you already know. Whereas filtering, it has to figure out what you want based on past experience, things you've told it already. So maybe if I'm if I know that I want to cover explosions, I'm going to have a running search for explosion, and I can do this in TweetDeck, right? I can just say search explosion, add column, and now I've got explosion as a column. In a similar vein, one thing that's very common that I'll want to do, especially if there's a large public event, right? So this is the type of event that you really go to social media for. If it's a private high-level meeting, you don't have people tweeting about it. If it's a plane landing in a river, everyone sees it. So it's these sort of public events of widespread interest that you go to social media for. And often you know where they are. So a very common task is, there was an explosion in Switzerland. In fact, let's do that right now. Switzerland. It doesn't say where in Switzerland. Let's try it anyway. So this is a tool that takes geolocation data and plots the tweets. Apparently I have to zoom in to begin. Is anybody tweeting in Switzerland? Maybe not. Or it's just taking a long time to respond. So does anyone know how it gets the information on where the tweets are? How does it know where the tweet came from? Right, geolocation on tweets. What fraction of tweets have geolocation? First of all, who's turned it on their phone? We got 2 and 20. Sometimes 2.5. It's about 5% of all tweets at this point have geolocation. So yeah, we don't really see anything in Switzerland. Maybe there's just nobody tweeting in Switzerland. If we try Hong Kong, assuming this is actually working. There you go. Yeah, just nobody was tweeting there. That's lunchtime there. Maybe that's the problem. Oh, then people would be tweeting their food, right? They'd be like, look at this fondue. That's probably more of a dinner thing. OK, so there it is. It just shows you all the tweets from a particular reason. This is a tool called Eyewitness. It's pretty useful. It displays images if there are any. And you can search for particular things as well. I bet we won't get any. Yeah, there aren't any tweets with sandwich in it. That's disappointing. Okay. So that's a method of filtering information. You can say, show me things with photos out. Very helpful if you know where the event is. And there's commercial versions of this. This is a service called Geofedia, which is a pay service. It's relatively sophisticated and expensive. And it's Twitter plus a bunch of photo video stuff, right? So what it gives you is you select an area, and it lets you actually outline it using polygons. You can import shapes, so you can do things like, not just within 10 miles of a point, but everything on this block, or everything on one side of a border. And it will show you all of the media that's been posted from all of these services. So useful tools. We're going to look at something that's even more sophisticated than this. So this is a tool, a prototype tool called Seriously Rapid Source Review, or SRSR, which you had, it was in your readings, this paper. And it's got all this crazy stuff. And the point of this tool was to help journalists find eyewitnesses to events as they're unfolding, and to help evaluate the trustworthiness. Has anyone been involved in collecting and verifying social media for news reports? I think we got one nod. Yeah? You want to talk about what's involved? Or was that not a nod? Okay. No one. Well, so if you find a video of something, can you just put it up in your news report? Why not? You don't trust it, right? So, at, you know, and then there's copyright issues and other things too, but at minimum you have to verify it. In fact, it's a rather complicated procedure. Apologies, this is the best slide I could find of this because somebody shot it off a screen. This is the user-generated content process for the Associated Press. So the Associated Press for certain stories will output on its official feeds, you know, this is a video, this is a photo of this event that just happened. Are you able to read it, or should I read the steps to you? Yeah, you can kind of read it. So find the earliest example. So you're often interested in the very first one because the retweets don't help you. You want to know who posted it. And then you got to verify the source. So you have to look at their history. Is it a new account? Have they posted on this topic before? Ask them questions. So you do just straight up traditional journalism here. You got to contact them. So through social media is probably the first place because you have their information. But actually, the AP policy is to call them if at all possible. Get a real person on the other end of the line in real time on a voice connection and talk to them and say, you know, where did this picture come from? And it's this whole thing, you know, then secure permission. And then check this out, compare content with AP reporting. You know, does this, it's this sort of context and background problem. Does this jibe with what we're already seeing from the region? And then check with regional experts. So often, you know, there's a lot of stuff coming out of Syria, right? So, and the social media desk is you know, in, for the AP, the main operations are in New York and London. If you're doing something out of Syria, you should check with the Middle Eastern Bureau to make sure that, again, you want to avoid sort of the obvious mistakes that somebody with background knowledge would be like, oh, that's not Damascus. No, it's because they have a different shape of Sopstein, and that's not it at all. Language experts, you know, sometimes it goes down as far as verifying accents. Are the people talking with an accent that's right for the place that it's supposed to be from?
Last night, one of our classmates put up on Twitter a photo of some ambulances in Jordan across the harbor, and I think one of the Middle East news feeds picked it up and thought it was Jordan, the country.
Mm-hmm. So there you go, stupid avoidable mistakes. So I show you this to remind you that this tool, which we're going to look at in great detail, can only solve some fraction of this problem, right? Maybe the first two steps, find the earliest example and check sources social history. So we are not talking about automated news. We're not talking about automated verification. We're talking about a tool to help reporters do a job for which there's already a fairly sophisticated process. But having said that, you know, if we can help them do that, that's good. So this does a number of different things. The first thing they do is they try to classify the users using a machine learning algorithm. So one of the questions you might have, now there are different ways you might want to classify users of social media. The one that they chose here is based on talking to some reporters was, well, you want to know if they're, you know, already working in media or not, and if they're affiliated with a particular organization, right? So you know, is this the account of the, you know, World Wildlife Fund? Is this a well-known blogger? Does this person work for the BBC? You want to know that stuff really fast. So we have to build a machine learning algorithm to try to predict from the information we have what each person, and they just do it for Twitter, but in principle this could apply to any medium, which of these categories each person falls into. So we haven't really talked about machine learning, and we're not going to talk about machine learning very much in this course. Has anyone brushed up against it? Well, surprise, surprise, pretty much all machine learning starts with encoding the objects as feature vectors, so turning them into points into high-dimensional space. So how do we take a person on Twitter and encode them into vector features? What matters? What would we want to look at, or what would the computer need to look at to decide which of these categories they fall into?
Followers versus followees?
Yeah, potentially both. Number of followers, number of people who follow them. What else? The demographic information? What kind of demographic information?
Male, female, and
how do you know that, though? Yeah, all you have is their Twitter profile. Yeah. I mean, yes, but we don't know that information. What else? Start by asking yourself, what information can I get on an individual? Yeah, tweet history. Yep. What else?
The topics that I usually tweet about.
How do you know the topics?
Just studying the feed of the Twitter hashtag.
Hashtags they use. That's nice. Yeah. Mm-hmm. There's another big one. If I go here and I go, I have no idea who this person is. Check this out. Bloomberg News Reporter.
But you can write anything in there.
You could write anything in there. It's true. But the description is probably useful information. I mean, unless you decide that it's always going to be a lie and you want to ignore it completely. But yeah, all of these things. Oh yeah, favorites. The posts that they have favorited. They look at things like, you know, their retweeting and reply behavior, and also links. How often do they link, and where do the links go to? Presence, absence of named entities, that's like the hashtags we were talking about, also names of people, places, and organizations. And the topics. Digression. IPTC is the International Press Telecommunications Code, I think. I don't remember. It's this international body that defines a lot of standards for news exchange and news formats. And one of the things they have is this set of subjects. It's this tree, right? So within politics, we have diplomacy. And then within diplomacy, we have summit. It's like three or four levels deep, defines all of these different codes. And they actually have an automated system that will take a body of text and assign the subject to it, using very much the techniques that we've studied for assigning stories to topics, right? I mean, you take it, you turn it into you know, a word vector, you compare the word vector against known points in the space that have particular topics. And there's other techniques. There's lots and lots of different ways you can do this. So they take all of this and what they actually do, the actual machine learning technique that they use is called a nearest neighbor classifier. So first of all, you start with training points. So you give 1,000 Twitter profiles to humans and you say, is this a journalist slash blogger, an organization, or an individual? And so each, you know, the human looks at it and you know, picks one of those three. And then what you have is you have all these points in this high-dimensional space. and you know for each one what it is, and then you have this one point that you want to know, which is this question mark here, right? So you have the system is reading all of these tweets, and for each one it's looking at the person who wrote it and says, well, what kind of person is this? And all you do, this is a two-dimensional example, is you take the k closest points. So k is normally, 5, 7, something like this, some small number, normally an odd number because that breaks ties. And you say, well, of the 5 closest points, let's say red is journalist and blue is individual. In this case, you would say, oh, that's a journalist, because most of the close points are a journalist. Very simple machine learning algorithm. And so they do this. And first you need the training data, right? So start with almost 2,000 random users, of which are 2,000 random users plus a bunch of things that are known to be organizations and things that are known to be journalists. And then they didn't want to do this all by hand, so they sent it out to Mechanical Turk. But then, how many of you know what Mechanical Turk is? Mechanical Turk is a service offered by Amazon where you can pay a dollar or sometimes even less for a very small task. In this case, look at this person's Twitter profile. Tell me if they're a journalist, an organization, or other. And, so that takes a minute, and you pay somebody 50 cents to do that. And if you have 3,000 of those, then, somebody will do 100 of them in an hour, and they'll make $50. Probably less. But there's Mechanical Turk, and there's a bunch of these. There's Crowdflower. There's a bunch of these sort of online, simple task labor markets, which have been widely used in journalism for things like transcriptions or generating machine learning data is a very common use, all kinds of stuff like this. But of course, people make mistakes. So typically what you do is you have each item rated by more than one person, and you can pick best 2 out of 3. In this case, they just threw out anything where there was where there was an agreement. So they only kept points where 2 people looked at it and said that it was the same thing. And so what you get is a classifier. You get, I now have all these points in high-dimensional space, and when I want to decide what something is, I find the closest points and see how the humans labeled them. And it does pretty well, right? So of the things that are organizations, there were 1,532 known organizations. 1,300 of them, 41 of them, the classifier got right, and it tended to sometimes call them journalists when they were actually organizations. And you can see what this is called, a confusion matrix. It's for every possible input, what output did the classifier give you? And what you're looking for is you're looking for big numbers along the diagonal, because that's what you want. The diagonal is it's one thing, and the algorithm said it was that thing. So it does pretty well. It this looks like the worst error there. So that's 15% error or something. Yeah, something like that. Pretty good, though. And then they wanted to know, is the person actually at the scene? That's this little eye icon there. So you notice that in this interface, they've got ordinary people, journalists, bloggers, organizations. So already the user of the system can tab through it, the journalist, depending on what kind of source they're looking for. And then they've got this little eye, which indicates, does the computer think the person was actually there? This one I found really interesting. This is a hard problem. How do you determine if someone was actually at the scene of some event? Well, what they did is they looked for words like see and hear and touch, the sort of basic perception words. And it turns out there's a category. This is called the Linguistic Inquiry and Word Count Dictionary. This was originally built for psychologists, for therapists, for analysis of people's journals, because there's there's research indicating that people who are journaling about what they're experiencing, like writing in their journal every day, that is therapeutic. And so to try to understand this process better, they started to try to analyze what types of words people were using and how they changed over time. And so this is this dictionary of thousands of words for all kinds of things, you know, for emotions, for, talking about relationships, for talking about food, for talking about money, you know, all of these different words and sort of the different types of, they're grouped together in sort of psychologically meaningful ways. And there's two that they grab, so affective processes. Positive emotion is this category, and it has words like love, nice, sweet, or negative emotion, hurt, ugly, nasty. That's sort of what this dictionary looks like. But in this case, what they did is they used perceptual processes. So for the category of see, you have words like view, saw, seen, listen, hearing, feels, touch. It's all of these words that are about directly perceiving an event in the world, like in front of you right now. And so all I did was they looked for tweets that had these words, and if you had enough words, we said, this is an eyewitness. Worked not bad by a certain measure. Precision and recall. Who's heard these terms, precision and recall? This is from information retrieval terminology or machine learning terminology. Precision is if I ask for a bunch of things, you can think of it as false positives and false negatives. So precision is I don't have a lot of false negatives, right? So in this case, high precision because, you know, 9/10 of the tweets that had these words in them actually were tweets from high witnesses. So this is really good. It doesn't give me false positive, but I get a lot of false negatives because it missed 70% of the tweets because it only got 32%, where the person, you know, a human looks at the tweet and says, this person saw this thing, but the classifier missed it because it didn't have any of these perception words in it. So basically, it's precision and recall are interrelated because you can trade off one for the other. If we add more words, we'll miss fewer tweets, but then we'll start picking up tweets that are false. So precision and recall are always this trade-off between the two. So this is an okay classifier. If it has a little I, it's probably an eyewitness. So on the other hand, it's going to miss a lot of things. But it's very simple. You know, you could code this up in 20 minutes. There's really nothing to this, as opposed to the k nearest neighbor thing, which is a little more complicated. Other things that they look at, and this isn't machine learning. These are just things that are in the user interface. You know, whether it contains media, often very important to journalists, whether it came from a mobile phone, if there's geodata in it, geodata is a latitude, longitude, to geocode it and say, that means London. But geocoding is this whole complicated process by itself that we won't talk about, that you'll know if you've ever tried to do it. It's not 100% reliable. And also, where are the friends? Because maybe if we don't have the location of this person, but we know all of their friends are in London, then maybe they're in London, right? This is the sort of information that a journalist would look at and try to understand these things. So what it does is it just displays all of these things. So at the top, you can decide which type of person you want to look at it from. This little icon is if the computer thinks it's an eyewitness. This is the location, which is geocoded. This is the number of retweets. This is the type of the person. These are where the friends are. This little network graph is, I forget exactly how it is. I think it's, have they been retweeted on this topic or something. And then it does entity extraction. It tries to figure out what entities are mentioned in this person's tweets. And we'll talk about entity extraction in a couple weeks. You'll actually have an entity extraction homework assignment where you're going to take news stories and extract the entities from them. Do you think this worked? Do you think this was a successful piece of software? How do you think journalists reacted to this? Would you?
Is it possibly too much information for doing something on the fly?
Yeah, it's pretty complicated. I mean, I think it's plausible. I think the only way to know whether it's going to work is to try it. So that's what they did. So here's some representative reactions. What stands out about these? Or what do you think we can learn from reading these reactions?
Sounds like they're backstopping what they've already found themselves. Sort of finding the, I see context appears a lot.
Yeah.
The context is something they've already got and they're wondering about.
Exactly, yeah. So they may have already found it, yeah. But it sounded like, you know, it was useful. I would tend to focus on eyewitnesses and journalist bloggers. Okay, so if you're going to start your search there, then being able to strip away the people who were not eyewitness or journalist bloggers or to focus on that categories, it's helpful. Remember, you're not trying to build, I mean, you can get, you know, you could spend years getting your machine classifier to classify eyewitnesses with 100% accuracy. But the problem is not classifying eyewitnesses. The problem is doing this, okay? So, we can throw a lot of fancy algorithms at this, but it's the question of how does it fit into this whole process? And this is something we've really found with Overview, is that, you know, the algorithm and the clustering and the TF-IDF and all that stuff is, you know, 5-10% of the work. It's really about workflow. How do we make this fast to use? How do we make it easy to import documents? So they're really solving only a small part of that, because this piece of software is not going to call them on the phone and ask them whether they're really in Aleppo. So yeah, people liked basic stuff. Eyewitness filtering was successful. Good support for locations. And it's useful to be able to just search for videos. Because in fact, all the time, and we were told this in social media trainings, if you're working at the AP, what you're really going to do is this, explosion video. Because what you want is the video. There you go, massive sewer explosion in China. All right, good stuff. And then some fancy stuff, right? This entity extraction, it sounds really interesting to like pull out what are the things they're talking about, but wasn't useful. And they wanted different types of filtering that they didn't have. Which just goes to show, software design is about users, and you can't, it's very, very difficult to sort of guess at what the right set of features are going to be. You gotta give it to them and let them test it. Okay. Break time, and then we'll come back and we'll talk about comment ranking. Okay, comment ranking. We're going to talk about ranking. First of all, does everyone know what I mean by comment ranking? So it's this problem. There's 1,705 comments here. Most of them are crap. Maybe there's 10 that are good. And so find the 10 that are good. So this is, especially when you have large discussions, so you have something that's commented on by thousands and thousands of people, comment filtering becomes very important to structure the discussion because, you know the old saying, right? 99% of everything is crap. It's great. It applies to music, films, or, you know, any art form, right? Because someone will come to you and say, you know, I always thought that martial arts films were horrible. And your answer can be, oh yeah, well, of course most of them are horrible, because most of anything is crap. So anyway, same thing applies to comments. And so comment filtering is important for finding the parts that aren't crap. And also saving everyone's time, right? You want the really interesting thing, the really insightful or hilarious comment to be at the top. So how is this done in practice? What are some comment filtering or comment ranking systems that exist in the wild.
Something like Reddit.
So how does Reddit's system work?
You vote up and down.
Yep, up and down votes. What else?
Dig.
Okay.
Yeah,
it's sort of still around.
Still
yeah. So up and down votes. What things other than up and down votes?
Moderator.
Yeah, moderator can step in. So we're going to talk about non-moderator ways, because of course, because that's equivalent to the relationship between a human editor and a news personalization algorithm, right? It's always possible for a human to do a great job at this problem, but we can't use a human in all cases because we can't afford to, basically, right? You can't. Not everybody can afford their individual editor. Not every piece of content on the internet can have someone moderating every comment. So what else? There's all kinds of different mechanisms for comment ranking.
The number of replies?
Yeah, number of replies is an interesting. I mean, it's not foolproof, because maybe it's trolling. Maybe it's a flame war. Number of replies, number of likes, up and down votes, spam, Marcus spam blocked. Who said it can be an interesting one. Theoretically, you could filter comments by, is this person, reputation generally. Does this person have a good reputation? Lots of comment filtering systems have experimented with reputation. Lots of different ways. We're going to talk about a particular one, which is very illustrative. We're going to go into great detail in one very simple algorithm, which is actually the algorithm that Reddit uses, just to try to start thinking about some of the issues you have to think about with comment ranking. And really, this is not just comment ranking. This is any type of content finding system based on voting, which is YouTube videos, which is, just about everything has some sort of voting system. So, okay, we have these up and down vote buttons. And the most obvious way that we could put, sort the comments is, fraction of upvotes to total votes, so the fraction of upvotes, basically. That works terribly. Why?
First person to post can have bias.
Yeah, that's it, right? So, at first, no comment has any votes. And then one comment gets one upvote, and it goes straight to the top, and it stays there forever because the comments at the top of the page are the ones that are going to get voted on. Or someone votes one downvote, it goes to the bottom, and no one ever sees it again, even though maybe everyone else liked it. So one way to describe what's happening is there's a feedback loop here. You only vote on things that you can already see. So if something goes to the top, it's much more likely to get voted on. If something goes to the bottom, it won't get voted on. So we have to break out of that feedback loop. How?
Rank the power of the votes.
The
depending on, if something is in the bottom part and then voted up, then that vote up is more powerful than the vote up.
Yeah, so there's something about different votes will count differently. That's definitely part of the answer. Let's try to frame it this way. What if you could ask everybody in the audience, right? So every user, you could force every user to vote on every item. How would you rank the comments then?
Force every user to vote on every item,
yeah.
Then they would all be worth equal.
Yeah, exactly. Every vote would count the same, right? So you sort of want to you want to try to approximate what would happen if every user voted up or down on every item. And you say, well, it's sort of like you say, we're going to do a straight popularity contest. Now, of course, you don't always want a straight popularity contest. But we're going to say this is our baseline, right? We're going to imagine that every user votes on every item. And if we had that, then we would solve this feedback problem because, well, then every user voted on every item, so it's not possible for one to get stuck at the top or the bottom. And then we would just sort them by, you know, this one had 99% approval, this one had 95% approval, this one had 80%, and then you scroll to the bottom and it was like this one only had 1% approval. But we can't do that. But what we can do is we can apply a little bit of theory from polling and say, well, we can't ask every user to vote on every item, but we can generate estimates of the error from the fact that not everyone voted. So if you do a poll and you have a country with 100 million people and you do a random sample of 1,000 of them, you end up with a poll that's got a margin of error of like, 3%, something like this, right? You've seen this, right? Poll is, 70% support this law plus or minus 3%. So if we had a million Reddit users and only 100 voted, we can apply the same mathematics and say, well, the margin of error is, this over this. So this is the idea, right? Only a small number of people vote. And so this is basically the problem. So here, actually, what we have is 11 upvotes out of 16 users, so 68% approval. But only three of them actually voted. And actually, two of them, we got two of the downvotes and one of the upvotes. So it looks like it's only 30%. But if we had more people voting, we would see that it was actually much more popular because these upvotes are just not counted. And so there's some true proportion, which we're going to call P, and some observed proportion, which is what we see, what the input to the system sees, which is P prime. Everyone following so far? We're going to get mathy here. And then this basically is the problem. When we don't have a big enough sample, because you get this error, right? So if I've got 11 out of 16 are up and 5 of 16 are down, we say, well, some portion of those users will randomly be doing the voting. And if I may see 2 down, 1 up, I may see 2 up, 1 down, I may see 3 up. There's a certain sort of distribution of errors that I'm going to get from the pack that I'm taking a poll. And those errors may be such that although one is actually more popular than the other, they cross over because of the error. And I see one at the top of the bottom. So bad. Right? Here I get what it's actually happening is they're mostly red, but I see mostly green. And here they're mostly green, and I see mostly red. So they're switched. Again, this is straight sampling. So suppose that it's got 50% popularity. This is a distribution where if I took a different poll, I would get a different result. I may see something all the way from 0.4 up to 0.7 or something, depending on just randomly what I see. But the key point here is that the polling math tells us how wide that distribution is. So what we're going to do is rather than sort them by the observed vote, we're going to sort them by this lower bound here. We're going to say something only gets to be popular when we're sure that the least popular it could be is this amount. So again, same ideas, right? Theoretically, if I have 100 users and 99 of them said yes and one of them said downvote, and I ask one user, I could hit that one user who said no if I have one vote, right? So even if I have one vote that says no, I could have, if 99 more people vote on it, I might see 99 up. So theoretically, the vote could be very high or very low. So I'm not going to say I'm sure that this is more upvotes than downvote. I'm going to say I think, I'm certain within, 95% of the time, I think this is going to be the true answer. And this is called a confidence interval, and it's a basic idea from statistics. And what we're going to say is if I see some observed fraction, like I observe 70% or I observe the top one, p prime equals 0.75, whereas the real p is actually 0.18, But what I'm going to say is, if I know I see 0.75 and I know I've only asked 5 users, what is the range over which the true value is going to be 95% of the time? And so this is an old question in statistics. There's a formula for it. This is less scary than it looks. It's less scary than it looks because we're not going to derive it. I want to point out a couple things. It's only a function of 3 values. This is p prime, so what I observe. So I use p prime because I couldn't type in p hat. N is how many people voted in total. So if I had 3 up, 2 down, then n is 5. And p is 0.6, right? 3 out of 5. And then this is that alpha thing here, which is, you know, how certain do we want to be? It's, if I go back here, right, it's, you know, what is, it basically is cutoff, right? If I make this bigger and bigger, what it's going to do is it's going to say, well, my error is wider and wider. And you measure that in standard deviations. And if you've done any statistics, you know that 2 standard deviations, plus or minus 2 standard deviations, is the 95% confidence interval. Good. At least one person is nodding. Okay. So p and n, p prime and n, you see z is a constant you pick for your algorithm. And if you make z 0, basically as you make z smaller and smaller, what it's going to do is discount more and more in the error, and it's going to get closer and closer to just, well, what's going to happen is look here, right? You multiply the whole thing by z. So if this goes smaller and smaller, then this term is going to vanish, and this term is going to vanish. This term is going to go to 1. So it's just going to go closer and closer to what you saw. It's just how much of the possible error do I take into account. And then all I do is, rather than ranking by what I see, I rank by the lower bound on the error. So you can just, and you can really just type this formula in. It's like 2 lines of Python, right? It's not a big deal, really. So this is how it works. In this case, I'm going to say I've got 3 different examples, and the observed proportion of upvotes is 100% in each one of them, right? So in all of these cases, every vote that I had was an upvote, but I had different numbers. And this score ranking, when I have only 1 vote, it gives me only 0.28, not 1. So it's really pushed down the vote. And the reason it's pushed down the vote is because I only have 1 vote, so I'm actually very uncertain as to what the result is, because I only saw 1 vote. If I've seen 3 votes, it's a little higher. If I've seen, that should be 5. If I've seen 5 votes, it's up to 75%. But it's as I see more and more votes, it's going to get higher and higher and closer to 1. So as the number of people who votes increase, this score is going to get closer and closer to just being what I actually observe. By the time I have 100 people voting, if I have 100 people voting and 75 of them voted up and 25 of them voted down, I'm going to be pretty sure that the true answer is actually 75%. And here's another example. In this case, I've seen only 3 votes, but 2/3 of them were up votes. But because I've only seen 3 votes, it's really pushed it down. It's saying, well, I don't think it's actually 66%. I'm gonna give you 27%. Is what it's saying is that, you know, 95% of the time, I think the vote's going to be at least 27%. But that's all I'm willing to say. But this one, well, again, the true vote, I see 60% up votes, but it dumbs it down to 31%. Right, so it really depresses the votes. It shifts everything down. And the interesting thing to note is that what we're really doing is we're pushing comments with smaller numbers of votes farther down the rankings, or making the upvotes count for less when we have fewer of them. And so here you can see what it's doing, right? It's the same example, 2 up, 1 down. If I just rank by the observed proportion, that p prime thing, this one ranks higher. But if I use this confidence sort, which is what this is called, then this one ranks higher. So it's an almost trivial algorithm to implement. You can take your comment voting system and you can do this in three lines of code. You just take, you're already counting the number of up and down votes, you just apply this formula to rescore them, which I actually did somewhere. There you go. Where's the definition? It's in the scroll back. There you go. There's the function. This is a language called Scala, which I don't expect you to know, but it's pretty straightforward, right? By the way, the reason it's this plus minus thing is that I can also take the upper bound. I can say, you know, if I say plus all of this stuff, I'm 95% certain it's not higher than that. But we're not interested in that because we don't want to be optimistic. We want to be pessimistic about our comments chances. And so there it is, two lines of code, or three, I guess. And there's me doing the calculations for the slides. You know, so that's the proportion I see, and that's the number of votes, that's the confidence interval, and that's whether I want to shift up or down, and that says 0.41, and that's on this slide here somewhere. Anyway, that's it, really. Questions? Was this reasonably clear? This complicated formula doesn't even really matter. In fact, my guess is that all kinds of other things will work pretty well. The thing you want is that when you don't have many votes yet, the upvotes count for less. That's really the only thing that we're doing. And we're doing that in a statistically principled way, but it doesn't really matter. It's gonna work as long as you can discount the votes in some way. And I show you this both because it's a useful algorithm, but also to say, I want to get you thinking about feedback effects in filtering systems. You start asking questions like, why are some songs popular and some songs nobody ever hears? And partially, that's because some songs are awesome and some songs nobody wants to listen to. But actually, when you do this experimentally, there was a great paper about an experimental music market where they manipulated, so they had, first of all, different random trials, and they manipulated various variables in terms of how often people, you know, were prompted to try different songs. It was an experimental attention market, is what this really is. And feedback effects are huge. You know, why does Gangnam Style have 1 billion views? Is it because it's awesome? I mean, it is kind of awesome, but lots of other things are awesome. Or is it because once it had 100 million views, it was much more likely to be reported in other media and get more attention? Attention is a feedback effect. Once something has attention, like think about this in journalism, right? If everybody's talking about something, it's a story. So then more people are going to talk about it. And so your filters are subject to this issue, and you have to think about whether that's what you want. To some extent, it is what you want, because otherwise everything is, you know, has the same amount of attention. And the whole point of a filter is to direct attention to a small number of items, a very small number of items, out of the huge set. But the question is, which one? And in this case, the answer is, we're going to say direct attention to the ones that we are sure most people will like based on our analysis of the polling error. Okay? Good. Recommendation systems. Who can give me an example of a recommendation system?
Amazon.
People who bought X also bought Y. Facebook? Recommended friends. You may also know this person. It's actually a really good example, a little bit outside what we're doing. You're filtering people instead of stories. I like that. Anyone else?
Pandora.
Yep, classic. Classic stuff. Most of these work on an algorithm very similar to the one I'm going to describe. This is it's sometimes called collaborative filtering, although technically collaborative filtering is anything where people work together. But this was really the first collaborative filtering algorithm. It's called user item recommendation. And here's how we're going to phrase this problem. We're going to talk about looking at movies. And we're going to say that various users have seen a movie and given a rating, you know, how many stars was this movie? And then for a movie that I haven't seen, I want the system to tell me what the rating is. I want to guess the rating for something that I have no information on. So this is the fundamental, this is a fundamental personalization algorithm, right? So for a story that I have never seen, is this a good story to show me? Afterwards, am I going to be glad that I saw it? So this, we're gonna, the way we're gonna do this demonstration is we're gonna say it's some sort of rating scale, you know, number of stars, 1 to 10, whatever. It could also be a binary variable. You know, is this person gonna retweet it? Are they gonna click on the headline? Are they gonna put a favorite star on it? But the basic idea is the same. Are they gonna buy it? Is another thing. You know, try to predict whether someone would buy it if you show it to them. And this algorithm, this is fundamental. This is not just personalization. This is, you know, there's entire advertising industries built on this type of algorithm. And it scales up and, you know, you'll find it's fundamental. Okay, user item matrix. So a very important point here is, as opposed to all of the work that we've done in the past three lectures on content analysis, so document vectors, feature vectors, clustering, there's no content here. We know the computer never does an analysis of the pixels in Jurassic Park for this matrix. This is entirely data from user ratings. So this is actually an orthogonal filtering dimension. And also, it's often very, very sparse, right? So I've got this all filled in. Normally, this thing is like a million items wide, like literally a million items wide. If I'm doing a news personalization system, I have possibly a million stories that I might show the user. And you know, any particular user has only read 10 of them that day. So it's very sparse. And there's different ways to describe this. We're phrasing the problem in terms of guessing that unknown value. But it's very easy to turn that into a filtering system, because all you do is you rank things by highest to lowest guessed value. Here's another way of saying it. So we've got this user item matrix. Here's the users down the side. Here's the items across the top. We're trying to figure out what this is. And we can think of it either as generating a prediction. So what would user A think about item J? Or a recommendation, which is what would user A think about all items, and then give me the top 10. But it's really the same idea. And again, this is called collaborative filtering. This is the classic collaborative filtering. This was invented in the 90s for a group email system. So, you know, this was, you know, way back in the day before there was Google Groups, before there was Facebook. There was a lot of discussion on big long email threads, and it was a system called Group Lens, and the problem they were trying to solve is all of these people are talking about all of these things on the email list, which conversations are worth paying attention to? And it was exactly this sort of collaborative voting process. Actually, Group Lens was even simpler than this. But old idea. So how we're going to do this is we're going to suggest things that are similar to things that I've already liked. So if we have 100 stories and, you know, I thought that 5 of them were really good, then find me ones that are similar to that. And if you think about it, this is, you know, this is like if you look at Pandora or iTunes or any of this stuff, it's basically what all we're doing, right? Find me similar items. But we have no idea what the content of an item is. We're not doing text analysis. We're not doing video analysis here. The only data we have is these ratings. So how do I tell when two items are similar? Yeah.
If I already liked 5 out of all of 100, then whoever also liked this 5, and then whichever else they like, that might be my interest.
Right. So I see if a similar set of items were liked by someone else. That's the core idea there. In fact, we're about to define a similarity function between two items. And the only data we have is this matrix. Anyone want to guess what the similarity function is going to be? So the question is, I have item J, which I want to guess, and I'm going to see if I've already seen item K, and I really liked item K, and item J is similar to item K, then I should recommend item J. So how do I tell if J is similar to K? Yep. Did you read the paper? Then that's an excellent guess. So the only information we have between items I and J is the ratings for each user. And so all we do is we look at items that where at least what are we looking at? Where one user has rated both of them. Because if I have a user which has rated one item and not the other one, I actually don't know anything. So I look at all the users who have rated both items I and J. And then I just sum those all together effectively. And there it is. This formula should look very familiar. In fact, you implemented this formula with a slightly different input values. You just did this. And notice even what's this stuff here? What's the denominator? Yeah, this is some. It's the length of the vectors. So you're normalizing. Why? When we did cosine distance for documents, we normalized to cancel out the effect of the length of the documents. So what are we canceling out here? What are we normalizing for? Somebody said something, but I didn't hear it. Yeah, the number of people who've rated it, right? So if I'm asking, okay, is Superman similar to the Fifth Element? And maybe there are only 5 users who have watched both Superman and the Fifth Element. Because remember, I don't get any information from users who have watched one but not the other. Or maybe there's 500. But just because we have 500 examples of the rating doesn't mean that they're much more similar than if we have only 5 examples. It means we'll get a much more reliable estimate of the similarity, but it doesn't necessarily mean that they're closer. That's not what we're looking for. So that's why we do this normalization thing. And there's various things that you can try to do. Remember in the beginning, the first lecture, we talked about these non-uniform scales, and I said if you ask people to rate something on an item of 1 to 10, what are the most common answers going to be? Anyone remember what that distribution looked like?
10.
Yeah, 1 and 10, and often 5 as well. You often get each end in the middle. So, you know, if there's some user who just thinks everything sucks, or for that matter, you know, you find this on Netflix, right? Everything has 4 or 5 stars. There's nothing that has 3 stars. And so in order to sort of account for that, one thing you can do, and this is actually the same formula, except you're just subtracting off the means from each element. It's actually exactly the same formula. You know, I dot j is just the sum of the pairs of I times for each element. And so it's the same thing. It's the sum of, you know, for each user, you're taking that element for one item times that user for the other item. But now you're just subtracting off the average of all ratings for that user. And then it's the same thing on the bottom. You're just normalizing. You're just shifting all of the columns of the matrix so that they have zero mean to try to account for this non-uniform scale. When they do comparisons in terms of predicting, like successfully predicting, you know, what a user is going to rate a movie. So Netflix has exactly this problem. They want to guess how many stars you're going to give a movie before they show it to you, which means that you have a very clear metric for how well you're doing, which is, how close did I get to what they actually rated it? And so based on that metric, this does slightly better. The other way you can tell how well you're doing is if you have a big training data set, you hold half of it as a test data set. So you train it based on one half of the data set, you predict the other half and see how well it works. So this is an example of a machine learning problem where there's a very simple way to measure whether you're doing it right or not. And then all we do is we generate the recommendation by taking the average of the ratings of for all similar items. Right? So I'm this user, you, and I have a bunch of ratings in my row of the matrix. And I ask for each of these items, how similar is it? So I'm trying to rate item I, right? So I ask for each of these items, so for item J, how similar is it? And if it's perfectly similar, then I want to have exactly the same rating. And if it's zero, then I don't want to use that rating at all. So what I do is I take a weighted average, which is just this. It's the similarity between, so what I'm trying to do is guess what user I is going to think about item, user U will think about item I for all similar items. And I use N as the subscript. I say the similarity between item I and this other item N that I voted on already times the rating that I gave to that item. So it's a weighted average, and then the denominator just makes the similarity sum to 1. So we just normalize against that sum. Is this way too much math for 9 p.m. on a Friday? Do you understand the fundamental idea of what we're trying to do here? Anyone want to venture to try to explain the basic idea of what we're doing?
Can you go back to that slide at the start of the, when you're talking about similarity? I think you were saying, sorry, no, too far.
here or this
we're
one?
We're only comparing, we're only comparing ratings that are rated for both items. That's what you're saying, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because if I didn't vote on another item, then comparing how similar the item I want a rating for against that other item is not helpful, because I don't know, you have no information about what my vote was. Right? So I'm going vertically across the matrix because I'm trying to compare the similarity of ratings for across all users, but I can only do that where both users voted. Which is important, right? Because this matrix is mostly empty. Which also means this is how you do an efficient implementation. If I have 1 million items and 1 million users, I can't store 1 million times 1 million ratings. But I don't have to because it's mostly zero. So it's exactly the same as you did for the document vectors, where it's mostly empty space and you just store these key value pairs. So it's an efficient algorithm. It only takes as much time as there are, I actually have ratings.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's as far as we're going to go with this algorithm. Interestingly, you can also run this to generate, to recommend users based on items. It's the same math. You just transpose the matrix, right? So in that case, it would be I generate a rating for an item on a user by looking at all of the users, figure out which users are similar, right? So I take a similarity function between users by comparing, taking that cosine distance, that dot product of the ratings, and I find the similar users, and then I give a rating which tells me, which is a weighted sum of what other users rated it based on how similar they are to me. And it actually gives, you can do it either way. It actually gives very similar results. It's kind of a weird thing that this algorithm is so transposable.
So is the idea with that you would find a similar user and then recommend items that other user has purchased but the first user hasn't?
Right. Yeah. So I can either, remember the fundamental problem is I'm trying to find one entry of that matrix, right? What is the recommendation for this user on this item? And I can do that either by looking for items that are similar based on pairs of users who have given similar recommendation or similar ratings, or I can look at users that are similar and see what those similar users said. So it actually works both ways, and there's later work in trying to integrate both of these types of information in a more sophisticated way. But basically this works. And basically, I mean, if you read the in your recommended readings was the Google News personalization paper. It does a slightly more sophisticated version of this. This is still fundamental, and it's certainly fundamental conceptually, in the same way that document vectors and TF-IDF are fundamental conceptually. This is a building block. And so, actually, if you think about it, you've now got quite a few building blocks. You've got purely algorithmic solutions based on content analysis. You've got purely social solutions based on who you follow, which does filtering. And then you've got different types of hybrid solutions. You've got comment filtering algorithm based on the confidence sort and the user item recommendation system. And you can put all of these pieces together. There's an enormous amount of information that you have when trying to recommend a particular item. So in our case, a particular story to a particular user. And there are lots of different filtering systems. Right? This stuff is all the time happening on the web. So you should recognize many of these. Of course, there's the Facebook news feed. There's basic comment filtering. This is the New York Times recommended for you. They're like personalized news thing. There's applications whose whole existence is filtering. There's Flipboard. How many of you have tried that? Yeah, so that recommends based on your social media feeds. So it looks at how many people have retweeted and how close are they to you and that sort of thing. You can imagine doing similarity scores between me on Twitter and other users on Twitter based on, do we retweet the same information? Or you can imagine similarity based on, do we have the same friends? Anytime you can give a similarity metric between users, that's a way of building a recommendation. Prismatic is very interesting. It uses both social and content recommendations. I actually want to show you Prismatic, because it's pretty cool. Here's mine. And what you do is you give it interests. So machine learning, finance, acrobatics, data mining. And then it finds stuff for you. And it does it partially based on content analysis, like doing topic analysis of all of this stuff. It constantly just scrapes the web. And it does it partially based on social analysis. So you also give it your Twitter handle, and it looks at who you follow and you retweet. And it looks at the links that you retweet, what were they about? It goes like 10 levels deep, and they actually came and talked to us in a previous class about how it works. And so it knows that I'm working on a story on gun violence, so it gave me some gun stuff. Anyway.
On that first story page, what does that 999 mean? Right.
Where?
In the middle. Just below the head.
Oh, that's, I have no idea.
It's the Guardian paywall, is it?
Oh, I think it's saying that's the price, yeah. Interesting. I don't know. I guess that's new. So very sophisticated filtering systems, and they're all over the place. Twitter's trending topics is a filtering system. Any trending topics is a filtering system. How many of you read that piece, Can an Algorithm Be Wrong, which was in the readings? That's very interesting. That's all about people complaining that Twitter was censoring them because their story didn't appear in the trending topics. But which Twitter denies, and they've explained a little bit why, but you know, actually one of the problems with filtering algorithms is that they start to get very complicated. Right? We looked at the beginning of this class, you know, gun popped to the top of the list for the State of the Union speech for 2000. And you know, TF-IDF plus ranking, and that can be considered, you know, a part of a filtering algorithm. And you know, we've been deep into this, so you were able to answer the question, why did the word gun go to the top of that list even though the speech wasn't really about guns? It's because you know the details of the algorithm. Well, most algorithms, not only do most people not understand how the algorithms work, but they're secret. Twitter doesn't want to tell anyone how the trending topics work because then people would spam it. All of these algorithms can be gamed, and if you know how they work, they're easier to game. So it's actually kind of a problem. There was a beautiful phrase in that that article. It was something like, the algorithm claims to know the mind of the public. Right? The trending topics, I love this, Friday night. The trending topics, Twitter is telling me that right now, Vine, Ways to Get Slapped, True Life, and Netflix are all things that are on people's minds. Well, according to who? According to what? Well, the answer is according to their algorithm. And we know some things about their algorithm. It's not just frequency, because otherwise, you know, whatever is more popular as a baseline. So the classic example is like, you know, Justin Bieber would always be number one, right? So it involves change over time. The velocity of something is what they call it. So their algorithm is something about how many tweets, but also how fast that number is increasing over baseline. And it also filters by region. And it's got some anti-spam special sauce in it. It's this complicated thing that somebody has put together to try to solve all of these problems. And more and more, this affects what we see as, or what we perceive as, what is going on. And it interacts really interestingly with human editors, because, for example, Google News actually looks at where the editor placed the story. If it was on the top of the homepage, it gives it more weight. But of course, you get feedback effects, because if it has more weight at the top of pages, then the filtering algorithms are going to say this is more important. So algorithms are already everywhere deciding what we see and what we do. And one of the things I'm trying to do in this course is get you to think about how they're put together, and not just what they do, but what we want them to do, which is really an open question, because that is really only a question that can be answered by people who know how to design better algorithms, which is, I'm hoping, is you. So to sum up, there's a lot of different, we call them signals. This is originally something, is a language they started using at Google when they talked about ranking things in search engines. Might be even earlier than that. It comes from statistics originally. Signal detection is this whole theory. We can look at all of these different things, right? We can look at stuff and you know, what the content of the item is, so text analysis. But then we can also build a filtering system that has no idea what the content is. which is maybe really helpful if we're trying to rank videos or things that it's hard for a computer to understand. We can look at all of this stream of social data, right? So the, you know, what people are sharing or liking or clicking, not just what I'm looking at, but what everyone else is looking at. We can look at the social network of who's following who. That can be very interesting information. We can look at good old-fashioned links, URLs. We can look at links that are shared through social media. We can look at comments or discussion and all this stuff, how old it is. If it's news, we want to know how many hours have elapsed since it happened. Probably we want some sort of decay value. And actually, in your readings, there's a reference to another commenting system. I can't remember. Anyway, if you poke around, that whole discussion we had about how Reddit ranks things, there's, you know, 6 or 7 other pages like that that describe different ranking algorithms for other commenting and aggregation systems, and most of them have a time value, also called gravity is sometimes what they call it. I think the DIG ranking algorithm had a term called gravity. Let's find out. No. I can't find it. Oh yeah, here you go. Hacker News. Who here knows what Hacker News? Yeah, it's exactly what it sounds like. Oh God, Lisp. Anyway, there's this gravity factor, and there's other places where it's similar, but I mean, basically it's just a formula that's based on time. It's the idea is things sort of float down. Here you go, you can see that it's item, hour, age. And gravity is sort of how fast things sink down over time. It's just this idea for that. But if you poke around on the web, you can find dozens of these actual formulas that people are using to ranking things, right? You can also ask, what has the user already seen? This is one that might not be obvious to think about, but I actually know that Prismatic does this. In fact, I can show you this. If I go here and I refresh my homepage, I'll get something different every time I do it, because it tries not to show me things that I've already seen, or even Prismatic actually tries to include diversity in their algorithm. And one of the ways they include diversity in their algorithm is, if I've just shown you a ton of machine learning articles, show something else next time I refresh. Oh, now it's making a liar out of me. Anyway, they do have a term. And then not just this data, but you can ask not just how many clicks have I gotten, but you can look at the time derivatives. How many clicks did I get in the last hour? Which is very important for sort of trending things. And I think Weeboscope must do something like that, yeah? Look at you know, how many I got today is not just how many I got over all time. Here's a little picture of what is available to a filtering algorithm. I love making these little pictures because, you know, I love PowerPoint, spending hours with these little happy faces. Generally speaking, three categories: the content of the item, the user's data, and everyone else's data. And I want you to think about this because your next assignment is to design a filtering algorithm. And the first thing you're going to have to do, actually the first thing you're going to have to do is decide who your users are. But the next thing you're going to have to do is list all of the data that you have available to use. And you don't have to use all this data, but potentially all of this data is available to you. But the next thing you have to do is you have to decide, how can you tell when the filter is doing well? So how do you tell when the filter is doing well? You've just spent 3 days getting this algorithm to work based on, you know, whatever you're basing it on, item filtering and ranking and confidence intervals, and then you run it and it gives you some stories and you look at it and you're like, is this good? So what's a good filtering algorithm? How do you evaluate that? tested on humans, yeah. So that's one way. That's actually what Google does for search rankings. And when they make changes to their search engines, what they do is they have user rankings, your A, B, right? So for this search, which page do you like better? So that assumes that humans have, on average, a sense of what is good, which is very often true. You know, and it's basic user testing. It's what businesses have always done, right? Try to make a product that people like. In many cases, in many fields, there's a much simpler answer. If you're Amazon and you're trying to do product recommendations, how can you tell if you have good recommendations?
If people buy through the recommendations.
Yeah, if people buy it. If you're Netflix and you're trying to recommend movies, how do you tell if your recommendation system is working?
If people are downloading those films, are
they? Or if they rate them highly, right? If they you know, thumbs up on the movies you recommended. If you're, you know, in a lot of cases, the metric is money. If you're selling ads, you're looking for what? How can you tell if your ad customization system is working? The what? Commercial rate? Conversion rate, yeah. Click through a conversion, right? And all of these things are important to journalism because journalism has a, you know, you need a business model or you don't exist. But fundamentally, journalism is not entertainment, and it exists for reasons, or at least it has reasons for existing other than making money. God knows there's better ways to make money. So that's the question I'm going to leave you with, and that is actually part of your assignment, is how would you tell whether you've built a good filtering system or not? And in fact, we're going to flip it around, and I'm going to ask you in the assignment, the first thing you have to do is decide who your users are, so you can pick journalists, if you're trying to build a social media filtering system to help journalists with stories, or you can pick, you know, professionals in some niche, or you can pick students, or you can pick just general interest news. And then the next thing you're going to have to do is tell me, well, what are you filtering? So is it going to be social media data? Is it going to be Facebook posts? Is it going to be the whole web? Is it going to be a newswire? So pick users, a data set.
When you say pick users, are we talking about the people that will be using this filter system?
The people who
are writing the program for, basically.
Yes, the people who are going to be using the filtering system to control what they see.
So in a newsroom or something will be sitting there using it to find whatever.
Yeah, if your users are journalists, they'll be in the newsroom. Yeah. Yeah. But you can also say, like, you know, like Flipbook or the New York Times recommendation system, that could also be just a consumer.
Yeah.
So you get to pick. And then you get to pick what you're filtering. So is it all news stories? Is it the news stories from a particular organization? Is it all social media data? And then you have to explain to me what data you have available. Right, so going back here to all of this stuff, what are this stuff do you have? And generally, these are the categories of things you have available. And then the next thing you have to tell me is, what are you trying to do? What kind of filter is this? You know, you may not be able to measure quantitatively whether you have a good filter or not. You know, that's difficult. If you can do that, that's helpful, very helpful. But at least describe in words what you hope to accomplish with this filtering system. What type of news is it going to give me if it's a news filtering system? How is it going to adapt to the user? What needs does it fill? Maybe how is it different from all of the other filtering systems? So you're gonna design this filter, and you're not gonna write the filter because that would take a very long time, but you're gonna design it, and you're going to give me pseudocode, which means you can. So any of this stuff, like we've discussed, you know, item recommendation, we've discussed, document cosine distance. We've talked about topic models. All of that stuff is fair game, right? You don't have to, you can assume the use of standard algorithms, but you have to explain to me how you're going to put those algorithms together to try to fill this design goal. And again, this is going back to the last lecture. I had those two slides. One was a mathematical formulation of the filter design problem, which is a relevance function. You're going to give me pseudocode for that relevance function. But the other one was the broader definition of the filter design problem, which is, what do I want it to do, and what are the constraints on what is possible? And that's where your answer has to lie. And so this is the assignment. It's up on the blog. It's due Tuesday.
So seeing that we're deciding who the users are,
yep.
You don't have a specific solution in mind. Obviously, it's sort of open-ended.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And in fact, I'm willing to go fairly open-ended with this. If you get really wild ideas, maybe you should check with me first. But, here are some examples.